We've got a block of annealed 4130 medium alloy steel clamped up here in our vise, and we're going to see how this HIE 1-inch indexable end mill performs cutting a variety of features. So before we cut some steel, how did I decide on the HIE insert mill specifically? I know I want to use a 1-inch general purpose roughing end mill suitable for a wide variety of jobs. So I'll go to the Haas tooling section of the website and then select milling cutters. Then I'll select indexable end mill bodies and use the cutting diameter filter to narrow down my choices. Now we only have three tools that meet our criteria, and I'll choose the HIE body because I know the smaller inserts of the HIE end mill cut very well in a variety of situations. Now, which inserts do I use with it? All of our indexable tools have related inserts shown at the bottom of the page, or you can navigate to the insert section of the website. Because I don't know exactly what grade I need, in a new tab, I'll go back to the milling inserts main page. Here, we can find information on the various carbide grades we offer. After reading the description of the grades, I see that HU30 is a versatile choice that performs well in steel, stainless steel, and cast iron. This grade is great because one insert will cover many jobs and materials. I'll choose the MHS chip breaker, as the grade chart tells me it's the general purpose chip breaker, which is what I'm looking for today. Now, I'll go back to the HIE cutter page and add the HU30 inserts with MHS chip breaker to my cart. Then I'll open up the insert page. Here, we'll open up the technical documents section to access the speeds and feeds chart, and I'll print that out and save it to my computer to reference while I'm programming. This tool is a real workhorse because it can cut a broad range of features in a variety of common materials. We can face the top of our part, do some shoulder work, maybe some full width slotting. And when we need internal features, like pockets, we can ramp into them using either a straight or helical path. Also, this cutter can plunge cut, which is a great strategy to use when the rigidity of your setup is low, as all the loads are transferred axially into the spindle and workpiece. We'll show a variety of those cutting strategies so you can get a feel for these cutters in real life situations. And we'll show two examples of our speeds and feeds, one with the cutting values right in the middle of the recommended range, and then a second one with everything turned up near the max. So let's get rolling. We'll start off facing the top of the part with our mid-range speeds and feeds. We're running 600 surface feet at 50 thou depth of cut and 10 thou inch per tooth feed, which is near the upper end of the feed range, but because of the low depth of cut, there's not much cutting force. Next, we'll shoulder mill around the outside of the block. I see this insert can go up to 217 deep per pass, but we want to leave a little room for burr formation as the cutter dulls, so I'll back that off to 200 and we'll take 190 thou off the outside. Here, we're still at 600 surface feet, but we bumped our chip load down to a programmed 6 thou per tooth, but because we're using radial chip thinning, my effective feed is actually just below 5. We'll go around 3 times to get 600 thou total depth of cut. Next, we'll cut a full width slot. I still have my depth of cut set to 200 thou, so we'll do 3 passes to get a 600 deep and are using the same 600 surface feet and 6 thou inch per tooth feed. Since we have TSC, TAB, and this is a coolant through tool, we definitely want to have one of those turned on so we don't recut any chips. Because this is steel, we'll cut this dry to prevent thermal shock of the inserts, but we still need to evacuate the chips with tool air blast or the auto air gun. If we were cutting stainless steel, we'd want to use coolant to prevent work hardening. Now, we want to machine our final pocket. Since we don't have a start hole, we'll enter the pocket with a helical ramping cut. If we look back at the HIE technical details document, I can see we can ramp at up to 9.5 degrees for the 1-inch tool. but I'll back that off to 7 degrees just because I typically do not ramp at the absolute maximum unless needed. Also, we need to pay attention to the minimum and maximum helical ramping diameters. In this case, I chose 1.9 inches or slightly less than 2x diameter. In a different situation, if we had enough space, we could also use a straight ramp as well. Now, we'll finish roughing out this pocket using adaptive clearing with the 15% or 150 thou step over, 200 thou depth of cut per pass, and a programmed 6 thou per tooth chip load. But because of radial chip thinning, the cutter is only seeing 4 thou 3/10 chip load. So that completes our test run. We removed 19.2 cubic inches of material in 12 minutes. Now these tool paths are not fully optimized. We're just using this as a time comparison for the next run with higher speeds and feeds. This was mainly to show that if you use our middle of the road speeds and feeds, you should have a successful cut right out of the box. All right, I loaded up a new blank. Let's see how this tool does with more aggressive cutting conditions. I've set all my speeds and feeds to the maximum recommended values on the technical data sheet. Now, of course, it should go without saying that when you start getting near the limits of the tool, you should approach cautiously and pay attention to how each portion of the cut performs in case any issues develop. Every material and setup is different, and what worked 2 weeks ago might just be different enough to cause problems this time around. When we approach our maximum speeds and feeds, we need to be sure that our setup and tooling is as rigid as possible. You can see our block is very rigid and stout, held in our new co-branded Haas Kurt DX6 vise. Also notice the cutter fits perfectly in our Weldon tool holder with no excess overhang for maximum rigidity. So let's get rolling. Alright, that sounded really good, considering we were at the maximum recommended values in a medium alloy steel. That cycle took 7 minutes, 13 seconds, so our time improved about 40% just by increasing the speed and feed. But remember, you don't want to exceed the maximum recommended values, or problems will occur pretty quickly. Our insert edges still look great after 173 cubic inches of material removed across 9 parts. The surface finish from the HIE cutter looks good for a rougher, but since this is a roughing tool with a limited depth of cut, we still want to finish everything with our HSPM 5/8 4 flute solid carbide end mill. Here we're cleaning up 10 thou on all surfaces at 800 surface feet and 4 thou per tooth. After a quick pass around with our solid carbide end mill, we have a very nice surface finish and high dimensional accuracy. So as you can see, the HIE Indexable end mill is a versatile and capable roughing tool that has a place in almost every shop. Hopefully this helps quantify its capabilities in real life, so you're not left guessing next time you need a new tool. We'll be back soon with more videos like this, where we focus on a specific tool and show you how it cuts in real life, so you don't have to guess when selecting a new tool. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.